I do solemnly and sincerely declare and affirm. That I will well and truly serve our sovereign lady the Queen in the office of constable. Without favour or affection, malice or ill will. And that I will, to the best of my power, cause the peace to be kept and preserved.
Well, everybody tells the policeman that he's doing such a grand job, such a worthwhile job, such an important job. We can't do without you. And at the same time, they will pay a typist, and this is within my experience, they will pay a typist or a girl clerk in an office just as much money as they will do a policeman.
The public must be made to realise that we give them a service. And in the police force at the moment, there is talk about strike action, militant action. But I must say that we don't really want to take strike action, but you never know what we may be forced to do on more militant lines than we've got at the moment.
For the British policeman to come out on strike is unthinkable. It couldn't happen. And yet it did happen 50 years ago. 50 years ago, the police struck for better status, better pay and better conditions. They struck and there was anarchy in the streets. The policemen who supported the strike of 1919 were sacked and never re-employed. Today, three men who lived through it all visit a former colleague at his home. Ex-Inspector Amos Warburton is now 77. In 1919, as a young constable, he defied the order to strike and remained on duty amid the rioting that followed. The strike split the force down the middle.
On the Friday, we all met at St. George's Hall Plateau. And I should say, I wouldn't know how many policemen would there be in Liverpool at that time, comrades?
Approximately 2,200,
yes.
I was going to say, about 3,000 policemen. There were some from Birkenhead and some from Wallasey. And I think the people in Liverpool were afraid when they saw a body of men like ourselves, six-footers and 14 and 18 stone, and just come back out of the army. We didn't care what would happen, you see, because we wanted to... to reshape the police force.
What were the immediate results of the strike?
Well, it was almost verging on revolution, as the central part of the town, I'm referring principally now to places around London Road, because I saw that, what happened. The rougher element very soon collected together in massive crowds. They were marching up and down Liverpool, in London Road, breaking the big plate glass windows, throwing out suits of clothes, rolls of cloth, and all commercial commodities for anybody to help themselves. And there was no policeman there to protect, no policeman anywhere. At that particular time, it was almost on the verge of revolution.
Mr. Warburton, you, in fact, didn't come out on strike. What was it like to be a policeman in the heart of a situation like this?
We went out from Hatton Garden to London Road on the double. And when we got there, the scene, as Mr. Nicholson described it, was absolutely chaotic. The shops were being looted right and left. People were trying on shoes in the streets. And we sailed into them with our fists, and we scattered them.
What was the reaction of your colleagues who had come out on strike?
Well, I'm not prepared to say, because I don't know. We weren't thrown in contact with them.
The reaction, as far as I can remember, was very, very bitter.
How did you feel as you watched this looting going on?
When I got down to these places where all these crowds were milling about, my first reaction was, a little bit gleeful to think that this will show the authorities, well, we cannot do without a police force. But afterwards, on second thoughts, I felt a bit sad. To think that a city like Liverpool was now being sacked. And I felt a little bit of remorse to think that the authorities were stooping, you know, to allow this thing to happen, because it was all in the hands of the government.
Today, the keeping of law and order in Britain's streets increasingly becomes a political issue. Police methods have been streamlined to keep them one jump ahead of the criminal. But from the average bobby's point of view, If attention is to be focused on his responsibilities, is more thought going to be given to the conditions under which he works? Within the force, there's a growing feeling that they do a job where the hours are too long, the risks are too great, and the pay is too little.
I suppose I'm an average policeman. Starting off, you're very keen at the beginning. You experience things which you've never seen before in your life. And as time goes on, as I said, I have 12 years in now in the police force and have seen some things. And I've had various experience with officers and the police force as a whole, and I don't think I would join again.
I'm a detective, but thinking especially of the uniform chaps, I think the present shift system we have in Liverpool is absolutely grinding. And certainly it must take years of a man's life.
In the last 10 years, the annual number of robberies in Liverpool has risen from 66 to 466. This call is to a housebreaking, carried out in broad daylight in one of the city's better class suburbs. For detectives Scott and Fulcher, it's a routine call, filmed as it actually happened. At this moment, they don't know what's been stolen. There should be 2,900 policemen protecting the life and property of the citizens of Liverpool and Bootle. But the force is 25% below strength and has been for the past 14 years.
I'd like to get outside. I'll just go and examine that glass outside.
Well, get out on the front of you.
The police service has got an awful lot of things wrong with it. I mean, gradually the lawlessness and vandalism and hooliganism is taking over in this country, and the police are holding their own. But as pressure is being put upon them by these vandals and by these people who are committing crime, the police have no reserves to call up to combat this increase in crime. And the only way they can get these reserves is to increase the police pay and conditions. But strike action, industrial action, is not my method of doing it.
I wouldn't like to see the police go on strike, but I would be quite prepared to go on strike if it was universal. It would be a sad day, probably, if we had to go on strike, but I think we should have the threat of a strike.
What do you mean?
Well, if we could be given the powers to go on strike, if we so wished, if it would mean that we would get better conditions and better pay.
And do you see this as the only way in which you're going to get better conditions, better pay?
Well, looking about me and reading the papers daily, all the other occupations, I feel that this is the only way they're getting their better pay. And people threaten to come out on strike, and within a week or two, they get what they want.
Among your friends, how many think like you?
I would say 50% would agree with me. That you have to have the threat of a strike to get better action. We want the action now. If it was tomorrow, it wouldn't be too early.
I'm done with the chains tomorrow!
No company and no surrender!
Tonight, the Reverend Ian Paisley comes to talk to his faithful Protestant following. In Liverpool, with its large Catholic population, it could mean trouble.
Well, it looks like they're in the hall now, and they're going to be there for about an hour, I understand. The men can disperse now, take the refreshments, and they are to be back in the position at the time, 1:09:15.
Very good, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Good job.
Thank you, sir.
All right.
Right, good evening, gentlemen. We're a problem this evening of a demonstration, plus students causing a bit of bother, and therefore it'll be necessary to be on our toes, because in addition to the demonstration...
The briefing for the mobile police units, the task force. Later, Paisley will march through the city, but there's still the normal routine to be followed, for Liverpool has a bad record for violent crime.
Even if there is trouble at St George's Hall or on the way back, X-ray 3 were responsible for the city centre, they must stay there. I don't want the thieves to start a riot in one part of the city in order they can ransack the other. This is the worry I've got.
Hi, lads, come on, give it a few minutes.
No.
You don't know anything about it?
No.
What sort of gloves?
I just stopped him going up there.
Driving gloves, aren't they?
That's right.
That's why it looks suspicious, you having them in your possession, doesn't it? Hey?
Religion and politics form an explosive mix. So, too, do police work and politics. This is a society in which the minority voice speaks more and more insistently. The policeman increasingly finds himself given the task of holding the neutral ground, keeping two rival factions apart. He doesn't like the job. He calls it being the piggy in the middle. Every day of last year, 10 men resigned from Britain's police force. It isn't difficult for them to get other jobs and to double their money at the same time. But the most disturbing trend is that among the policemen who've had enough, there are more and more men with 10, even 15 years' experience. Jeff Tolman served 12 years with the Liverpool force, and at the end of it, he was a constable, earning £1,000 a year. After 2 years on the docks, he's a foreman. Yet, as a policeman, he was both conscientious and hard-working.
Why, then, did you leave the force after, what, how many years' service?
12 years' service. Basically, pay. I was working shift work, Saturdays, Sundays, Christmas days, all the bank holidays. I was taking home £20 a week. And I found that outside they were paying more money for the similar hours.
And what can you now take home in 1 week?
Well, depending again on overtime, I'm doubling the money.
Have you any regrets at all at having left the police force?
No, none whatsoever. I should have done it years ago.
If you had the support of your colleagues and you were now a policeman, do you think that you could come out on strike?
As a last resort, yes.
Do you think that coming out on strike, though, would achieve the objectives which the police are seeking now?
Well, I think the government's got to wake up to this, that they've got a dissatisfied police force. And something drastic must be done.
What do you think of the fact that your husband was paid £20 a week after 12 years' service to the force?
Chronic. You know, he'd done his duty, he was doing his duty and working hard, and he was an experienced man. He knew the system and... you know, quick ways of doing things, or for the training and the experience, I thought it was awful. And to try and bring a family up, even today, on the pay, even they've had this 8.5% rise, it's still not enough. It only works out at about £2 for a top con. And by the time, you know, the government or Mr. Wilson's had his cut, it doesn't account to very much.
Are you disillusioned by the way that the force has been treated?
I'm very disillusioned, and I think every other member of the police force is very disillusioned about the way we are being treated now and being fobbed off all the time. We've asked for things, we've asked for rights, privileges, which should be really ours, and we're not getting them. It's got to the state now where we do want some hardline action.
What do you mean, you're fed up with all the prevarication that's gone on?
Yes, we are. We're just being treated and fobbed off by everyone all the time, the Home Office in particular, and it's about time that they came out and saw the light of day and helped us a little bit.
Steady eyes. Front the right number.
One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight.
The number of discontented policemen is growing. The Police Federation are considering resolutions asking for the freedom to strike. Ominously, they come from the big cities, Manchester, Birmingham, Bristol. There's no likelihood of the police striking tomorrow, but the resolutions highlight a widespread dissatisfaction, similar to that which led to the police strike of 50 years ago.
What do you think would happen if there were another police strike?
Oh, I couldn't visualize it. I think they would bring in the troops right away.
Well, bad enough in 1919, I think it'll be worse now, 1970, if the police did come out on the side, wouldn't it?
Seeing them in Northern Ireland reminded me very much of what the streets were like here during the police strike.
You think it would be that bad?
Yes. Oh, Northern Ireland would have nothing on it. No, if the police came out on strike, what's happened in Northern Ireland now would have nothing on it. No.
What do you think of the lessons today in the 1919 strike?
I think that the responsible authority, the councils and the government was as much to blame for that strike as the strikers themselves. They consistently refused to listen to any overtures, peaceful overtures.
I've taken part in the police strike and I've taken part in the general strike. And both strikes, I've come out the worse. I've had to go back to work with tail between my legs and I've lost a job that I wanted to be. I wanted to be a policeman.
Police work is just sheer hard graft. And it certainly must take years of a man's life to work the hours he does and in all kinds of weather.
You have to help the threat of a strike to get better action. We want the action now. If it was tomorrow, it wouldn't be too early.
Well, I cut two blocks off the front guard and then moved the guard. It was the base, the hasp at the bottom, which has two locks on.
What exactly have they stolen?
Well, amongst other things, do you want a whole list? 22 bags of coal, axes, electric lamps. That was in the doorway, obviously forcing the locks.
This doesn't belong to you?
No.
And you found this break yourself?
Well, I came in, I think people had seen it before.
I see.
But nobody had bothered.
I see, yes. Well, we'll commence inquiries, and if anything comes up, we'll let you know, sir.
Fine, thank you.